honorable guests, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to our forum on integrating INT into GBA and the national system, come launch ceremony of Policy Research Center for Innovation and Technology. I'm Bobo, MC of today. Today's grand occasion marks PolyU's key milestone at its 85th anniversary celebration. The event is also live broadcast on YouTube. A warm welcome to our audience online. The development of a vibrant, innovative, and technology industry is key to the future success of Hong Kong. We have witnessed great initiatives from different ecosystem partners in driving the INT development in Hong Kong and the Greater Bay Area. Today's event, we are honored to have Mr. Charles Lee to join us as our keynote speaker, as well as many heavyweighted speakers sharing their insights in the panel discussion session. The event brings together government officials, LASHCO members, major INT stakeholders, supporting organizations, researchers, and students who are our core pillars for the future INT development. To kickstart this grand occasion, may I invite Professor Jing Guangtang, President of PolyU, to deliver us a welcome remarks. Professor Tang, please.
Ms. Lilian Zhang, Mr. Charles Lee, Council Chairman Dr. Lam, distinguished speakers, panelists, and guests, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I'm delighted to join you for today's forum on integrating innovation and technology into the GBA and the national system, as well as the launch ceremony of the Policy Research Center for Innovation and Technology, which is also known to us by its acronym, PReCIT. It's my great pleasure to welcome you all most warmly to this official debut of PReCIT as part of PolyU's 85th anniversary celebrations. The development of a vibrant innovation and technology industry is the key to Hong Kong's future success. The Communist Party of China's 20th National Congress report pointed out that the country will fully implement the strategy for invigorating China through science and education. Hong Kong must proactively integrate itself into the nation's development plan by formulating a clear innovation and technology roadmap that leverages Hong Kong's advantages as an international city and as part of China under the One Country, Two Systems principle. For more than eight decades, PolyU and its predecessors have played an important role in answering the call of times and contributing to the advancement of Hong Kong, the nation, and the world. The establishment of this center, the PreCIT, is just another timely step taken by PolyU to respond to the key national strategies, including the 14th Five-Year Plan, the development strategy of the GBA, and the Belt and Road Initiative. All these initiatives unleash unlimited opportunities for the future development of Hong Kong. Now, through fostering interdisciplinary policy research, PreCIT aims to serve as the advocacy body of PolyU to make recommendations on long-term issues for Hong Kong, particularly those to do with the innovation and technology industries. Now is the time for us to celebrate. Congratulations to the Policy Research Center for Innovation and Technology. I'm sure the center will play a unique and significant role in the development of Hong Kong into an international innovation and technology hub. I also look forward to the insights to be shared by Mr. Charles Lee, Professor C.C. Chang, Dr. Ao Tu Poon, Dr. Sunny Chai, and Dr. Stephen Wong on the theme of integrating Hong Kong's innovation and technology into the GBA and the national system at this forum. It is very timely that their insights are offered just before the announcement of the Hong Kong Innovation and Technology Development Blueprint to be launched very soon by the Hong Kong SAR government. Ladies and gentlemen, before I conclude, I would like to extend my sincerest gratitude on behalf of the Hong Kong Polytechnic University to you for being here with us today and for all your past support to PolyU. Your continuous support is important for PolyU to pursue excellence in educational research, making our best endeavors for the betterment of Hong Kong. Finally, I wish you all an enjoyable ceremony and a fruitful forum. Thank you.
Thank you, President Tang. Please be seated. Mr. Xu Jie, Deputy Director General of Office of Hong Kong, Macau and Taiwan Affairs of the Ministry of Science and Technology of China, is now in Beijing. He has prepared a video for the ceremony. Please enjoy.
尊敬的滕景光校长、孙东局长、各位科技界同仁、女士们、先生们、朋友们，大家好！非常高兴同各位朋友云端相聚，共同出席。 融入国家与大湾区创新科技论坛及科技与创新政策研究中心开幕典礼，我谨代表科技部港澳台办公室对论坛的举办和研究中心的开幕表示祝贺。党的二十大报告指出，巩固提升香港在创新科技等领域的地位，推进粤港澳大湾区建设，支持香港更好融入国家发展大局。 为实现中华民族伟大复兴更好发挥作用。今年6月30日至7月1日，习近平主席在视察香港期间，勉励香港与粤港澳大湾区内地城市珠联璧合，强化产学研创新协同，着力建设全球科技创新高地。当前，世界百年未有之大变局加速演进，国际力量对比深刻调整。 世纪疫情叠加，经济发展存在不确定性，深化区域交流合作，共同应对风险挑战的重要性进一步凸显。粤港澳大湾区建设是习近平主席亲自谋划、亲自部署、亲自推动的重大国家战略，是推动"一国两制"事业发展的新实践。近年来，在习近平主席的关心指导下， 粤港澳大湾区国际创科中心建设取得显著成效，深圳、香港、广州创新集群全球创新指数连续两年居全球第二，科技创新能力持续增强，一系列重大科技基础设施和重大创新合作平台加快落地，创新能力建设布局不断深化，粤港澳大湾区国家技术创新中心。 以及各类新型研发机构快速发展，新兴产业引领能力大幅提升。香港高校拥有与国际接轨的传统优势，香港理工大学应用科研实力突出，目前建有两个国家重点实验室、两个国家工程技术研究中心香港分中心，围绕轨道交通、航天工程、大型基建设计等领域，在内地。 尤其是大湾区积极开展研发布局，将自身的科研优势与大湾区的产业优势相结合，培养了一批新兴产业人才。未来，科技部将与香港特区政府一道，深入落实党的二十大精神和习近平主席对香港科技创新工作的系列重要指示精神，融通创新要素，汇聚两地智慧与力量。 支持香港科技界为国家深入实施科教兴国战略、人才强国战略、创新驱动发展战略作出更大贡献。最后，预祝融入国家与大湾区创新科技论坛取得圆满成功。希望香港理工大学科技及创新政策研究中心为香港创科发展、粤港澳大湾区国际科技创新中心建设。 两地科技创新合作提供更多有影响力和建设性的政策建议。祝各位身体健康，生活愉快。谢谢大家。
Thank you, Mr. Xu. Professor Sun Dong, Secretary for Innovation, Technology and Industry of Hong Kong SAR Government, has prepared a few words to congratulate PolyU and PReCIT. Please welcome Professor Sun.
Dr. Lam, Professor Tang, Professor Chow, Professor Cui, honorable speakers, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I'm most honored to join you all today at the PolyU's 85th Anniversary Forum on Integrating INT into GBA and the National System CIRM Launch Ceremony of Policy Research Center for Innovation and Technology. First of all, I would like to congratulate PolyU on the achievement and progress made this year, and thank you for inviting me to speak on integrating INT into GBA and the national system. In the past few years, the Hong Kong government has invested an unprecedented amount of resources to promote the development of INT in Hong Kong, thus laying a firm foundation for the continuous improvement of our INT ecosystem. President Xi Jinping's visit to the Science Park during his visit to Hong Kong early this year demonstrated the importance and acknowledgement placed on Hong Kong's INT development and the expectation of Hong Kong contributing to the country's development in science and technology. Recently, the recruitment of payload specialists from Hong Kong demonstrates the country's confidence in Hong Kong's level in scientific research and development, as well as the country's care for the development of Hong Kong's young people. I would like to express gratitude for PolyU's staunch support in the recruitment, as well as the contribution to country's aerospace development. We will continue to contribute to the development of our country and to showcase Hong Kong's strengths in this aspect. Looking ahead, leveraging our country's strong support and our connection with the world, as well as the vast opportunities brought by the National 14th Five-Year Plan and the Greater Bay Area Development, the Hong Kong government will push forward INT development in four major directions with the vision of developing Hong Kong into an international INT hub. Among others, we will deepen our INT cooperation with the mainland and actively integrate into the overall national development. The Hong Kong Shenzhen INT Park in the Lo Ma Chau Loop is a bridgehead for INT cooperation between Hong Kong and Shenzhen. On the basis of one zone, two parks, and through in-depth cooperation with Shenzhen, we will study the trial implementation of a cross-boundary policy on INT cooperation in an innovative, exclusive, and designated manner between Shenzhen and Hong Kong. Meanwhile, we will give full play to Hong Kong's advantages as an international city and attract mainland and overseas INT enterprises to Hong Kong, providing key impetus to the development of an international INT center in Hong Kong. Before I close, I wish to congratulate PolyU on the establishment of the new Policy Research Center for Innovation and Technology. I trust that the center will play an important role in facilitating interdisciplinary collaboration for more impactful researches, in particular in the INT field. I'm sure that today's discussion would be inspiring and fruitful, leading to more bright ideas and innovation. May I wish today's forum every success and all of you an enlightening experience. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Sun. Apart from the recruitment of payload specialists, I'm sure PolyU will continue to contribute to the nation's development in science and technology. Next, Ms. Li Fangfang, Director of Office of Hong Kong, Macau and Taiwan Affairs, Chinese Academy of Science, will deliver us opening remarks through video.
尊敬的唐景光校长、赵汝恒副校长、各位来宾、女士们、 先生们、朋友们，大家下午好。很高兴以视频形式参加由香港理工大学主办的融入国家与大湾区创新科技论坛及科技及创新政策研究中心开幕礼。今年是香港回归祖国25周年，也是香港理工大学建校85周年。在此，我仅代表中国科学院向论坛开幕表示热烈的祝贺，向理大全体师生及广大校友表示诚挚的祝福。香港理工大学是一所历史悠久且充满活力的大学，在追求学术卓越的同时，不断推陈出新，在学生培育和应用研究等方面表现优异，为推动香港创科发展贡献了积极力量。通过举办本次论坛，共商大湾区科技及创新发展新机遇、新举措，将有助于进一步推动粤港澳大湾区建设，使香港更好融入国家发展大局。中科院高度重视与香港的科技创新合作，已与香港6所高校共建了22个联合实验室，其中与香港理工大学在应用数学、气溶胶与环境、粤港澳大湾区环境污染等领域共建了3个。此外，中科院在港设立香港创新研究院，在特区政府支持下，科研团队初具规模，科研成果陆续产出。同时，我院也积极推动和支持粤港澳大湾区院士联盟工作，积极参与庆祝香港回归25周年系列创科活动，取得积极成效。当前，全球科技创新进入密集活跃期，粤港澳大湾区国际一流创新资源集聚，研发和科技成果转化能力突出，产业链条完备，具有科技创新和制度创新的绝佳条件，在全国加快构建开放型经济新体制中具有重要地位和作用。香港具备优秀的创科基础条件，雄厚的基础研究实力，积极的人才引进政策和开放包容的创新生态环境，正加快打造国际创新科技中心。期望以本次论坛为契机，构建更深层次的合作共赢关系，聚焦创新驱动发展，加强科技合作协同创新，进一步提升大湾区研发实力和人才储备，加快培育发展新动能，为推动粤港澳大湾区建设和国家高质量发展做出应有贡献。最后，再次祝贺香港理工大学科技及创新政策研究中心成立，预祝本次论坛取得圆满成功，祝大家身体健康，工作顺利，谢谢。
Thank you, Ms. Lee. We have prepared a short clip about our new center. Let's find out more in the coming video. I hope you will join hands with me to support PreCIT in achieving its mission in the future. Policy Research Center for Innovation and Technology is founded in May. Although the center is new to the public, It has already carried out its mission as PolyU's INT advocacy body by submitting recommendations to policy address. PreCIT is grateful that the Hong Kong SAR government has incorporated our suggestions into the policy address to foster Hong Kong's development into an international INT center. Now is the time for our launch ceremony. We would like to invite our honorable guests to come onto the stage for the launch ceremony of PolyU PreCIT. May we invite Dr. Lam Tai Fai, Council Chairman of PolyU, Ms. Lillian Zhang, Undersecretary for Innovation, Technology and Industry of the Hong Kong SAR Government, Professor Jingguan Tang, President of PolyU, Mr. Charles Lee, Co-Founder and Chairman of MicroConnect, former Chief Executive of Hong Kong Exchange and Clearing Limited. May our Chairman and President please stand by our keynote speaker, Mr. Lee, please. Dr. Lawrence Lee, Deputy Council Chairman of PolyU. Professor Wong Wing Tak, Deputy President and Provost of PolyU. Dr. Miranda Low, Executive Vice President of PolyU. Professor Christopher Chow, Vice President in Research and Innovation and Director of Policy Research Center for Innovation and Technology of PolyU. And Professor Eric Choi, Head of Department of Applied Social Science and Co-Director of Policy Research Center for Innovation and Technology. Next, may we also invite PreCIT's core member of PolyU to the stage. They are Professor Van Yang, Vice President in Students and Global Affairs, Professor Godfrey Shen, Associate Vice President in Global Partnerships, Professor Haitian Liu, Director of Mainland Development, Dr. Winnie Tang, Adjunct Professor of Department of Applied Social Science, Professor Horace Murray, Associate Head of Department of Building Environment and Energy Engineering, Dr. Sylvia Liu, Assistant Dean of School of Design, Dr. Xue Yong Zhang, Department of Management and Marketing, and Dr. Gigi Lo, Department of Building Environment and Energy Engineering. May everyone please look at our photographer in the middle to capture this historical moment. To kick off the launch ceremony, on the count of five later, with all guests on the front row, please place your hand on our PreCIT artwork. Are you ready?
Five, four,
three, two, one. Press! Congratulations on PreCIT's official launch. We wish the center to becoming a leading INT advocacy body to formulate impactful strategies that light up the society like the PreCIT artwork. Let's capture this movement. Please look at our camera in the middle. May all PreCIT core members on the second row be seated, and guests on the front row, please remain on stage. One more photo, please. Look at our middle photographer. Thank you, everyone. May our guests on the first row please remain on stage, and our guests on the second row can be seated. Thank you. Next, may I invite all panelists and representatives of our co-organizers and supporting organizations to join us on stage for a photo in recognition of your support of this event. May we invite Professor C.C. Chen, co-founder of the Greater Bay Area Associations of Academians, Dr. Otto Poon, President of Hong Kong Academy of Engineering Science. Dr. Sunny Chai, Chairman of Federation of Hong Kong Industries. Professor Qingyan Chen, Director of PolyU Academy for Interdisciplinary Research. Mr. Brian Pan, Head of Innovation and Technology, Greater Bay Area, Invest Hong Kong. And Professor Christina Wong, Director of Research and Innovation Office. Mr. Mang Chiat Phai, Publisher and CEO of Master Insight Media Limited. Mr. Xiaolin Zhang, Vice Chairman and President of the Hong Kong Chinese Enterprise Association. And Ms. Zhang Li, Chairwoman of Chinese Financial Association of Hong Kong. Please get ready for photo. May all our guests stand closer for a photo together. And look at our camera in the middle. Thank you. Now, guests on the second row, please move a little bit forward to your right, to your left. Thank you. Good for a photo. Please look at our camera. Thank you. Let's give a big round of applause to all our guests on stage. We hope to see more interdisciplinary collaborations with all co-organizers and supporting partners. Thank you, all our guests. Please be seated. And may our VPRI, Professor Chow, please remain on stage with me. Professor Christopher Chow, Vice President in Research and Innovation of PolyU and Director of PReCIT, will now introduce us the vision and mission of PReCIT. Professor Chow, please.
Good afternoon, Ms. Lillian Zhang, Mr. Charles Lee, Council Chairman Dr. Lam Tai Fei, President Professor Tan Jingguang, Council members, honorable LegCo members, distinguished speakers, panelists, and guests, ladies and gentlemen. It's my great pleasure today to welcome all of you to the forum on integrating INT into GBA and the National System launch ceremony of our Policy Research Center for Innovation and Technology, PReCIT, which is our signature event since the center's establishment in May. Societal challenges have become more complex and multinational nowadays. Interdisciplinary collaboration is essential to formulate impactful solutions for tackling the issues effectively. In order to captivate PolyU's strength in innovation, the Policy Research Center for Innovation and Technology has been established to collect wisdom in the city and neighboring regions to come up with new ideas and strategies for three major areas, including carbon neutral cities, Greater Bay Area INT development, and Belt and Road development. with a view to dovetail with the national 14th five-year plan in supporting Hong Kong to develop into an international INT hub. Hong Kong has high-level scientific research talents with rich experience in basic research. The country has a huge market and actively provides space and supportive policies for talents and enterprises. Hong Kong and the mainland could complement our respective strengths to deliberate on cross-boundary integration proposals to foster R&D commercialization in order to unleash the potentials of the GBA and Belt and Road economy, as well as the opportunity associated with reindustrialization in Hong Kong. That needs a cross-boundary policy on INT cooperation, including the flow of material, capital, data, and people between Hong Kong and mainland provinces. PReCIT endeavors to formulate suggestions that support Hong Kong's participation in the national technology missions. Today's forum serves as a premier platform to initiate constructive discussion, and we look forward to collaborating with university communities, industry, and government for the betterment of Hong Kong. May I express our sincere gratitude to Mr. Xu Jie, Professor San Dong, Ms. Lilian Zheng, and Ms. Li Fangfang to celebrate PC's official launch. And special thanks must go to Mr. Charles Lee, Professor C.C. Chen, Dr. Otto Poon, Dr. Sandy Chai, and Dr. Stephen Wong to share their insight, as well as to our co-organizers and supporting organizations for their great effort in making this event successful. This afternoon, we are happy to have Mr. Charles Lee as our distinguished keynote speaker. Mr. Lee is co-founder and chairman of MicroConnect, and he will share with us how to accelerate the development in the Greater Bay Area in the areas of fintech and digitalization. We all know that Mr. Lee is the former chief executive of Hong Kong Exchanges and Clearing Limited. He orchestrated some of the most significant strategic initiatives in Hong Kong, including a number of cross-border trading schemes. His experience in bringing up innovative ideas to the finance industry is available to us in thinking of how to integrate INT into the Greater Bay Area and the national plan. Finally, your participation will certainly be an important motivation for PReCIT to become a leading INT policy powerhouse in Hong Kong and the region. We look forward to collaborating closely with all of you in our joint effort to foster Hong Kong's INT development. Thank you very much, and enjoy the rest of the program today.
Thank you, Professor Chow, for showing us PReCIT's future direction on how to support Hong Kong's participation in the national pioneering technology missions. Please be seated, Professor Chow. Coming up is the forum session under the theme of integrating INT into GBA and the national system. We are honored to have Mr. Charles Lee to enlighten us on the topic, leveraging fintech and digitalization to accelerate the development of the Greater Bay Area. Without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Mr. Charles Lee.
I hope you don't mind I take off my mask. Thank you for inviting me. Thank you for having me for this great occasion of celebration. I know most of the audience here probably are not finance related, but on the other hand, what we are doing today and what Hong Kong is likely going to play a role in the future of China is how to really leverage the massive advance of technology, particularly digitalization, and trying to transform our financial market. I have spent most of my previous careers and years of professional life running big market at the Hong Kong Exchange. Today, I'm probably on the other extreme of finance, which is really trying to find a way to finance little guys, truly the veins in our blood system, in the soil, deep soil of our real economy, the little shops, the little mom and pop businesses that ultimately form the bedrock of our economy. So you probably would be saying, no, why you're jumping from such extreme extent? Actually, what happens at the central market and what we are trying to make it happen in the smaller universe of a small economy has a lot in common, but digitalization is the only reason that we are now finally able to potentially bring the two of them together. As we all know, central market is all about big companies. The entire Wall Street model, which has been with us for 200 years, is essentially trying to solve one problem, that is accumulating capital, putting them together into larger institutions and organizations so that we can build road, build railway, build factories, and build modernization and industrialization. At that time, the model is premised on not having enough capital, and the idea is to put capital together and then put into the listed companies so that they can do the big things together, and we regulate and we invest in the underlies, which are big companies. That's the historical model. And because in this economy where we don't really know what's going on the ground, we require companies of size to organize economic activities so that we as investors are able to put money into those companies and then distribute the risk and be able to concentrate the capital into bigger enterprises, into bigger industrialization projects and factories and economy. But the world we are seeing today, particularly in the last 20 years, we are no longer in a society globally that we need more capital. We actually, if anything, have too much capital. The Fed, the monetary authorities of every country in the last 30 years has been printing money, print, print, print. Today we have so much money in the market that it's not about how to get the money together, it's how to get the money distributed to where it really matters. In that context, when on the one hand, we really have a lot of money, but on the other hand, the delivery system of that money into our real economy is still the old-fashioned Wall Street of requiring us to go through the listed companies. If you are a listed company, they're, by definition, very selected few. Globally, there are only 15 to 20,000 listed companies. In Hong Kong, we have 3,000. China have a close to 5, US close to 5, everywhere else together, maybe 20,000. Not all of them are trades every day. So literally 20, 30% of them trading every day. So essentially, globally, hundreds of trillions of dollars are trading literally just a few thousand underlines. That trading model, that investment model, while has been working for the last 200 years, are increasingly not working for the real economy, particularly a big economy like China. Because all the money is concentrated on the few thousand companies. If you look at Alibaba, if you look at Tencent, their stock has gone down about 70%. That's sort of a price movement. You would have thought the company already close to bankrupt. No, they are not. They're very healthy. But why investors lose so much money when the company is doing okay? That's because, in many ways, we're trading, investing with each other. We're no longer trading with the real people needing the capital to develop the economy, economic opportunities on the ground. So what we are doing here today, MicroConnect, in Chinese, 地管通, is a way for us to actually recognize something important that has taken place in China, in particular, that potentially could transform the way we invest. What is this big thing that has changed? It's really digitalization. If you think about China, or even globally 20 years ago, when commerce, how do we conduct commerce? In the past, commerce is conducted by big merchants, department stores. They put all the goods together in a big building called a department store, a supermarket. Then we all go in there and shop and spend. Whatever they have there is really our underlying product we purchase. Internet revolution changed everything there. Now we are able to shop by looking at millions of merchandise, and then we order them online, and then the platform companies settles the cash and merchandise together. That's called e-commerce. Amazon in the West, Alibaba, Taobao, and Jingdong in China. So that model today means that we no longer have to go to the department store. We could sit home and actually deliver particularly so much of the merchandise that would otherwise never be possible for you to be able to buy. We are today able to buy something from Xinjiang on some sort of a lamp that just slaughtered in the morning, and we can get them the next day delivered to us. In finance, we are seeing a revolution like that right around the corner, and Hong Kong can be the leader of that. What is that thing that has changed that allow us to potentially create a financial Taobao or Amazon? It's really digitalization. The reason in the past we are investing in big companies, not in little shops, is because we have no way of knowing what's going on with the little shops. What is their financial condition? What is their business operation? Are they healthy? Are they going to be okay? Or are they going to be gone the next day? We don't really have any idea, and we don't have any means to determining that, and therefore we are not able to put money into it. Today, digitalization in China have changed everything. In China today, there's largely no cash anymore. You do not carry cash around. You basically have your Taobao, your Zhifubao, your WeChat Pay, your credit cards, your Tonglian, your Yinlian. All the electronic payment system essentially allow us to conduct close to 99% of the economic transactions in China are essentially going through a payment system. That's digitalized payment system create a foundation for us to completely transform the way we finance, at least in the areas where we can go into the consumer economy. So the company's name, our company's name in Chinese is called the Di Guan Tong, drip irrigation. That name and concept is we are taking inspiration from the agricultural development of the country like Israel in the Middle East. Israel has no surface water, no rivers and lakes, and they have very little rainfall. So as a result, they're really, really dry, and agriculture is very difficult to take hold. But today, Israel is the largest exporter of fruits and flowers to Europe from the Middle East. How is Israel able to deliver that? It's through drip irrigation. They build a water gate, a water system, a micro worker system with plastic tubes that are connecting water to the very roots of the trees, of the plants, of the grapes, of all the economic producers that they are producing there. And they're doing it at night when the sun is now there evaporating everything away. They're doing it in precision. They're doing it with chemical, with fertilizers and with, whatever else that you needed to do in time, in precision. Think of that system in the real economic activities in China today. China today, all the shops are essentially digitally connected. We are able to see the revenue that is coming on every single tube of the shops in China today. With that transparency, with that visibility, there's no reason why we should continue to rely on the old Wall Street model of funding big companies, and hopefully they will find a way to get the money down there. There are a lot of small businesses in China today that are so vibrant, so strong, presenting great opportunities of returns for investment. But we just don't have a way of doing it in the past. But today, we at MicroConnect is essentially trying to solve that puzzle, is essentially trying to make that connectivity, and we have now finally found a way. So essentially, the idea here is that the revenue of the little guys, the shops, mom and pop shops, are not only visible, they are actually importantly can be splitted, can be intercepted, can be 截胡, meaning that if you want to fund a little guy for investment and you want to make sure that they pay you back in the returns, you are able to do it automatically, digitally, without him having to do anything. Everything can be digitally structured so that you are able to collect your returns every day, directly as a percentage of revenue. So essentially, instead of doing what we all know as debt, credit, which is really fixed income, or equity, stocks, which is taking a shareholder interest of a company, no point doing it at the little guy. The little guy, individually, very risky. There's no point holding a shareholder interest in a little guy because you never really know what's going to come out of it. Instead, we are now adopting a completely new way of financing, a new way of investing. We are investing in the company, in the shops, but instead of waiting for shareholder profit distribution, instead of waiting for IPO, which is never going to come for a little shop, or instead of waiting for them to pay you back in a year or two, as a credit, as a debt, none of that works in the traditional way. Instead, we're giving them money if they want to open another new shop, but then we are charging revenue distribution as a percentage of revenue every single day. So that is automatically taking the money that due to the investor. So instead of waiting for a big event in the future of repayment of your debt, or some sort of exit event of an investment in equity, like we are literally collecting our returns every day. By being able to design and structure our investment that microly important way, we are essentially are able to provide funding that is very cheap for the little guy. Why? Because if we give this little shop of funding, and as long as we're able to collect our returns every day, the moment the first day we're collecting the money, we're able to use the money and provide into another shop the next day. And then the second day we're taking money from the first shop, we're able to give it to the third day. And even on the second day, we are able to take money from the second shop, give it to the fourth shop. So we are able to use the same dollar quite a few times. The velocity of that is becoming possible, which means that we are able to make money, investors are able to make money from multiple investors for the same dollar, which means that we are able to allow each individual small owner not to have to pay for too much, because the investors still get paid a lot of money because we got paid a few times. In the past, you wait until a year later, you wait until 2 years later, or you wait until 3, 4, 5 years later. That's why you never know what's going to happen. That's why you have to charge a very strong returns to justify taking the risk for that long. This way, since we're collecting every day, and we are reinvesting that collected money every day, since we're exiting every day, we don't have to charge a lot of returns on each individual investee. That's the beauty of what this new way of investing is called, a daily revenue contracts, rather than debt or equity. It's called a DRC, daily revenue contracts. And that daily revenue contracts is automatically collected, what we call ARM, like a drawshow, because it's automated repayment mechanism. So this may sound very complicated. It is, and it is not. Once you really figure out how this is going to get done, we are able to really distribute massively into China. So today, we launched our company last August. It took us 4 months last year until December, we made a first investment into the first shop. And we invested in a hair salon. And then the first quarter of this year, the first 3 months, we invested 100 shops. And between April and August, we were able to do 900 investment in 900 shops. Today, we are already 1,600 shops throughout China, in every single provinces of China, except Taiwan. That's politically correct for me to say that. But otherwise, everywhere in the mainland, we have invested in over 100 cities. We invested in food and beverage, 餐饮. We invested in retail. We invested in services. We invested in cultural and athletic activities. 餐饮, we invested in all sorts of things, in 小吃, in 快餐, in shapu shapu, in malatang, in all sorts of noodles, all sorts of convenient shops. We even investing in automated kitchens, in hospitals, in schools. They're everywhere. And per investment, per shop investment is only 400,000 yuan. We're literally investing in a distributed manner. We invested in all sorts of convenience stores, supermarket chains, pharmacy chains, in services. We invested in hair salons, in pet groomers, in car washes, in dentists, in laundry services, in digging services, and you name it. Anything that we do during, in our ordinary life, we have invested in them. We are everywhere. And people are going to say, this whole pandemic, this COVID lockdown, consumer investing is supposed to be almost impossible to do. Yes, they have affected large swath of our economy. But don't forget that eating, drinking, getting basic services, these are gangxu, these are real demand that we can take it cheaper, but we cannot do without. So therefore, this sort of an investment allow us to see the most vibrant, most healthy, and the most resilient part of the economy in China. And because of money is used for CapEx, and we're buying from them on the existing shops revenue, and then we're funding them for CapEx, that means that only the franchises with strong desire to expand come to our businesses. So as a result of self-election, we are seeing indeed the strongest. Again, this is not possible in any other economies. A lot of people ask me whether or not you are able to do it in Southeast Asia, in America. It's probably difficult because the whole idea here is that we are able to take automated direct interception of revenue as a return for our capital. This is not about the invested shop owner writing us a check every month. This is about every day money is deducted before money hits his account. And in any society where you are able to use a lot of cash, which means that we are not able to capture that revenue, it's not possible yet. So which means that China, the digitalization, the deep and widespread digitalization and payment system is going to allow China to potentially transform our capital market, transform how investment is conducted, and allow us to truly pump money into the areas of our economy, into the veins of our blood system, and allow the most basic economic organs of our economy, the shop level businesses, to truly thrive and be able to truly enjoy for the first time access to capital. Though the investment doing very well, one big metric we use to measure and how to compare, we're investing in all the provinces, we're investing in all the different brands and different segments and services. How do we measure how successful we have? So we have designed this particular measurement called Micro Connect Cash Yield, Daily Cash Yield. In Chinese, it's called the Di Guan E. So basically, for every 10,000 yuan of investment, how much cash we are receiving every day. So we have invested, as I said earlier, 1,600 shops now. deployed about 700 million RMB into all the shops, about 400,000 per piece. Today, we are receiving 16 yuan 44 cent per day this year, year to date. So essentially, that basically says, for every 10,000 investment we made, we are receiving 16.44 yuan per day. What does that mean? That if you time 365 with 1644, that's about 6,000 yuan, which means that for every 10,000 yuan, every year we get 6,000 yuan back. So we'll get our money back within about 22 months. And then that money every day get reinvested into a lot of other, you know, shops here. So that's very healthy investment. You get your money back in less than 2 years. But that number during the pandemic went down to 9.88 cents when we had only 400 shops and 90 of them in Shanghai. Today, that number, the 16.44, which is our national average, that number in Shanghai today is still 10, 11. So it's, you know, COVID is still affecting. Beijing is about 11. So all these big cities are still struggling, you know, because of COVID. If you look at Guangdong, that number is 18 yuan. But if you look at Guangzhou, year to date, 1770. Months to date, 7. Because Guangzhou was shutting down largely this month. So anybody want to know the impact of COVID lockdown, just come to our computer, you know, dashboard. I'm going to tell you. Neimenggu, Inner Mongolia, 22. Gansu, I think it's 21. Qinghai is 21. A lot of the outer provinces, because it's not about the economy, they're necessarily better than Shanghai and Guangdong. It's just because the shops we invested there happen to be doing well. And, you know, we also rank a lot of the shops, every single shop. Some shops are making close to 90 yuan per day, so which means that they get the money back. A lot of the bubble tea, or the girls love it, and also some super car washes. I don't know why they just make so much money, but they probably have no competition. And then when people realizing how wonderful it is, then maybe people will, you know, adding more machines. You know, we have a Peking duck place that is generating massive returns. A lot of children's centers generating a lot of returns. In the malls, the parents dump them, and then, you know, they play, somebody teach them something, and then you pick the kids up in 4 hours, and you pay a pretty hefty price for basically a daycare. Just dump the kids so that the kids don't bother you. So we are investing in literally hundreds of different kind of businesses that is important in our daily lives. And this is the first time we have seen any capital market activities to be conducted that actually have that kind of a direct impact onto our businesses. And this sort of a distributed model of investment in the future will also allow us to conduct impact investing much more effectively and much more efficiently. For example, if you want to encourage our business, any business, to engage, to employ handicapped people, and you're able to offer kickbacks, then we will be able to offer to all the shops who hire handicapped people. For example, we invested in a hair salon chain called Miss Judy. Basically, white collar young ladies in office complex, they want to have their hair, you know, thoroughly washed and massaged. And it's a very popular brand. We invested in, you know, 20, 30 shops there. And they engage a lot of deaf and hearing challenged, you know, young ladies to do the work. They smile, but they're quiet because they don't talk. And they're booked online, and a massive waiting list for them. So this is sort of an investing we can finally help the little guys to succeed. But in the meantime, allow investors to make a very good return that in the past has never been available to, you know, to the financial universe. So we believe that the digitalization, the technology advancement finally allow us to find a new way that can put China potentially at a very different animal advantages and allow global capital to finally also access to this massive blue ocean of investment opportunities that is presented by the vibrant part of most vibrant part of the Chinese economy. And I hope that next year I'm going to come back to you and tell you that we have now invested in 20,000 shops and we're putting $1 billion to work. And by that time, we will truly see a very different, you know, financial market. And hopefully by that time, we will be talking about not only about Wall Street, but about Main Street. For that, I will see you next year. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lee. Please remain on stage, Mr. Lee. Your talk is truly inspiring. As a token of appreciation, may we invite our President Tang to the stage and present our souvenirs to Mr. Lee. One more photo. Oh, thank you. Thank you. Please take a seat. Now it's time for thought-provoking discussion after an insightful keynote speech. Director of Mainland Development as well as core member of PreCIT, Professor Haisen Liu, will moderate the following panel discussion for us. Together in this panel, we are honored to have Professor C.C. Chen, co-founder of the Greater Bay Area Associations of Academians, Dr. Otto Poon, President of Hong Kong Academy of Engineering Science, and Dr. Sunny Chai, Chairman of Federation of Hong Kong Industries. May Professor Liu and three panelists please come to the stage, please. May we have Professor C.C. Chen, Dr. Otto Poon, and Dr. Sunny Chai. Together here, we'll have Dr. Stephen Wong, Senior Vice President and Executive Director of Public Policy Institute, our Hong Kong Foundation, to join us. Please be seated, all our panelists and our moderator. Now I hand over the time to Professor Liu. Thank you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests. I'm Haitian Liu, a professor at PolyU and a co-member of PreCIT. Firstly, I would like to thank Mr. Charles Lee for your inspirational speech. On behalf of the audience, we want to pay tribute to your enormous contribution to Hong Kong's role as an international financial center and best wishes to your MicroConnect, your next world-changing fintech innovation. So let's give another round of applause to Mr. Charles Lee. Okay, so let's kickstart for our panel discussion. It's my great honor to chair such a distinguished panel. May I first invite each panelist to share your view on today's topic, that is Hong Kong's INT integration into GBA and national development strategies. 首先, 让我们有请, 我们的第一位, panelist, 他是粤港澳, 大湾区院士联盟的发起人, 中国工程院院士, 全国政协委员, 陈清泉教授为我们分享, 陈教授被誉为亚洲电动车之父, 并且呢, 他在上周刚被评选为 2022年感动湘江人物。 我们有请陈院士。
Okay. Thank you, Professor Liu. I would like to speak with Mandarin because some of the mainland technology terminals I'm more familiar by Mandarin. 各位嘉宾,各位朋友,大家好。 感谢诸委会的邀请，我非常的高兴能够代表粤港澳大湾区院士联盟出席融入大湾区国家创客的论坛。我用 PPT 来演讲啊。那么， 请下一页，下一页。好的，我主要讲三个意见。第一个意见呢，我回顾国家对香港科技工作的指示方向。第二点，我想和大家分享一下，我最近和深圳市合作，在那里要建立研究院，要成立这个科创基金。在我两个月以前。 深圳市政府邀请我去，我在那里待了一个月，谈谈我的体会。第三方面，提出香港科创的四个方向。下一个月，我们回顾习主席对我们的指示。
希望香港发挥自身优势，汇聚全球创新资源。 与粤港澳大湾区内地城市珠联璧合，强化产学研创新协同，着力建设全球科技创新高地。香港科技工作者是我国实施创新驱动发展战略、建设创新型国家的一支重要力量。希望大家继续弘扬爱国爱港传统，坚定创新自信，瞄准世界科技前沿，积极对接国家重大战略需求，着力攻克关键核心技术。
为把我国建设成为世界科技强国做出贡献。习近平指出，青年人是全社会最富有活力、最具有创造性的群体。习主席的五句话牢牢记住在我的心坎。第一句话，他说：“希望香港发挥自身的优势。” 第二句话，香港要回去全球的创客源。第三句话，香港要和粤港澳内地城市珠联璧合。第四句话，发挥强化产学研的协同作用。第五句话也是最重要的目的，着力建设全球科创高地。那么我们如何？ 更好地发挥香港的独特，特别要理解什么是独特地位和优势，背靠祖国，连同世界。第一，要利用好香港的资本主义制度，第二，要利用好香港良好的营商环境，第三，要利用好香港的自由的学术氛围。 我们要不断地理解国家给香港独特地位，什么叫独特地位？另外，什么是优势？以香港所长，贡献祖国所需，建设全球科技创新高地。好，下一页。 翻下一页，好吧。好的。那么，我们第二点，我要讲一讲这个我最近跟深圳市合作的一些感想吧。我在2017年创建国际院士科创中心，除了在北京，还有我们在这个德国、瑞典。 土耳其、以色列、加拿大和韩国都有分中心。这一次深圳市政府领导特别邀请我们的科创中心也在深圳落地，并且在那里建设设立这个科创基金。那么跟他们交流当中，首先第一点我的体会是，政府各个部门的之间的加强合作。 理顺合作机制，共同促进科创发展。在市政府市委领导接见我们的时候，他带领他的智能团队，包括这个发改委科创委人才局金融局科协一起跟我们讨论。讨论以后就形成一个文件。这个文件由书记、市长各个部门签署。 就便于执行。 根据以前的经验，如果没有一个共同的这样子的扯皮很多，就避免扯皮。所以从就业到现在两个月当中，我们都运行得非常快啊，效果非常好。也就是说，各个政府部门的这个 coordination 很重要，这是第一点。第二点，我跟大家要分享的，政府要一个利益集团 stakeholder 要紧密合作，特别是要调动专家和市场的力量。我们在以色列的中心，在瑞典的中心同样有这个体会。也就是说，一般是政府出钱、出资源、出资源提出目标，但是在运行当中是靠专家、靠专业人士、靠市场去运行啊。这个第三个意见呢，发挥资本的作用。刚才 Mr. Charles 讲得非常好，我认为呢，资本跟科技是珠联璧合，资本跟科技珠联，如何发挥资本的作用，如何发挥市场的作用，促进科技创新应用能够转化，不要这个论文堆在保险柜腐烂掉了。这么认为就变成论文工厂，并且它会腐烂。所以论文怎么转化为从科学变技术，从技术变产品，从产品变市场，科技和资本是珠联璧合啊。所以我希望在香港这方面更发挥香港自己的优势，能够释放高科技企业的动能性啊。下一页。好的，那么我对香港要科创的四大方向，刚才实际上孙东局长也讲了这个四个方向。第一个呢，是完善创客生态圈，实现香港再工业化。第二点，壮大创客人才库，增强发展动能，建设智慧香港，提升市民的生活素质，积极融入国家发展大局，同时巩固香港国际化的优势啊。下一页。好的啊，最后我的结束语啊，今年呢，我们特区政府会推出香港创新科技的发展蓝图。我认为未来这一两年，特别是未来这五年，是香港科创新局面实现宏伟蓝图的关键时期，所以期待香港能够抓住这个非常好的机遇，积极融入大湾区，积极融入一带一路，积极融入国家的创客发展，建设成为具有影响力的国际创客中心，为实现中华民族伟大复兴做出贡献。谢谢大家。
谢谢陈院士。Thank you, Professor Chen. Next, may I invite Dr. Otto Poon, President of Hong Kong Academy of Engineering Sciences. Dr. Poon, please.
Thank you, Professor. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. What I'm going to say will probably disclose my age. In the 60s and 70s, Hong Kong used to be one of the four Asian dragons. And the manufacturing part of the GDP accounts probably 25-30% of our economy. Of course, time has changed. And now, in spite of the government injecting substantial amount of money into research, R&D, universities, and different institutions, our GDP is less, in the manufacturing sector is less than 1%. Now, if you consider what has changed in the intervening periods, what we have done is that the Hong Kong business people, they move their manufacturing to the GDP, Great Bay Area or beyond, and hollowing out our industry, number one. Number two is that the Hong Kong business people in general are short-sighted. They want to make quick money. They are not interested in long-term investment in R&D. So as a result of these two factors, that's what we have now. 1% of our GDP is due to industries. Right. Now, as we all know, Hong Kong have 5 universities that are in the top 10, not 100 in the world. And we have many scientists, engineers, who are doing excellent research work at the universities and at the different institutions. But why are we not translating this R&D into business? I think, if I may say, I would say the research in Hong Kong in general is, I quote in Cantonese, 百花齊放, 100 flowers blooms. There's no direction. I mean, of course, academics should have great freedom. I think they should do whatever they are good at doing. But at the same time, I believe there should be some sort of leadership, some sort of direction. What the country, what China is doing, what the China expect us to do. And I think this is important. For example, I just quote two cases, materials. I think some of the Hong Kong's universities have excellent research establishment on materials, which is probably not the greatest area in China. Microchips is another area which Hong Kong have some advantage. And I can remember at the beginning of the Hong Kong Science and Technology Park, somebody from Motorola, he set up a laboratory to allow the Hong Kong companies to do chips in that communal laboratory, but that thing has disappeared. And so I think Hong Kong R&D, I believe, needs a bit more direction, more leadership to tell us to what we are good at and how we can contribute towards the whole economy, the whole industry of China. Right. So at the Hong Kong Academy of Engineering Science, we are working closely with the ITIB now to look at this situation. We actually make a recommendation to the government on two areas. Number one is that on translational research fellowship. What we propose to the government is that for the PhD students, I mean probably hundreds of them every year from the universities, after they graduate with a PhD degree, where can they go? There's no industry to absorb them. As a result, they go to overseas to continue their research, or in Hong Kong, they'll be unemployed. So what we are proposing is to the government to have a transfer, a translate research fellowship. Get the PhD students, if they are good at something, they believe in something, they believe that's good for the economy, that's good for Hong Kong and the nation, the government can give them a subsidy of say 50,000, 80,000 a month to allow them to attach to a company in Hong Kong or in the GBA area and continue their research, continue with their findings, and hopefully that can create some business from their research. And number two is that, as I said earlier on, Hong Kong government spend a lot of money in supporting different grants and everything. And yet, there's no critical mass. Someone get $1 million, $2 million, even $5 million, what can they do?
They will probably continue for their work for a year or so and then disappear. There's no critical mass that to create a substantial business. So what we are proposing to the Hong Kong government is establish a Hong Kong Industrial Development Corporation to the tune of, say, $100 billion, and allow the enterprising researchers, enterprising professors, they can probably start a business with a good size of money, a critical size in the order of 100 million or 200 million. Because I personally had a discussion with universities in Hong Kong, and there are professors who have very good ideas, but they cannot raise that sort of money in the market, $100 million, $200 million. Because set up a factory to mass produce their product, they would need a factory, they would need to continue the R&D, they would need to hire research people, marketing people, management to run the company. So the critical mass we consider would be in the order of $100 to $300 million to start. It's a real business. And these two ideas we have floated to the government, in ITIB, and also to the financial secretary. And in the latest policy address, I think the government had addressed some of our concerns, and they are we did a comparison. What the current policy, the latest policy address said, and what we have recommended to the government. And I think we are getting close. I think I believe that we will continue to talk with the government to persuade them on this translational research fellowship, and also on establishing the Hong Kong Industrial Development Corporation. Hopefully, with these two prongs of approach, we can rebuild our industries in the INT sectors. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Poon, for your observation on Hong Kong R&D ecosystem. Indeed, the Hong Kong R&D needs more leadership and direction. So next, may I invite Dr. Sunny Chai, the chairman of Federation of Hong Kong Industry. Dr. Chai, please.
Yeah, thank you, Professor Liu. First of all, I'm speaking on behalf of the Federation of Hong Kong Industry, not only because PolyU invited me under this capacity, and also I have three FHKI colleagues sitting here, Steve, Terence, and Teresa. But I do have one colleague from HKSTP sitting at the back. So to address Otto's comment about the 3DSIP labs disappeared because the utilization was less than 10%. So what does matter is the ecosystem. Someone put down the money, someone has to use it. So it's an ecosystem, okay? So I will come back to express my view as an industrialist for many years. So under the 14th five-year plan and the GBA plan, Hong Kong is stated clearly to be an international INT hub. And what we see from many of our research, R&D in Hong Kong, Professor Chen mentioned about the university in Hong Kong. We have five university, very good university, ranked within 100 of the QS ranking, and PolyU is one of them for sure. And comparing to other cities like London or New York, they have two, Japan has one. So the uniqueness of Hong Kong, the level of our university is to me is incomparable in the world. Okay, first of all. Second, if you look at the number of unicorns in Hong Kong, 18 of us, account for last year. Comparing to Korea, they have 18. For China, in account 2021, roughly about 517 unicorns. So what does it mean in comparing the number of unicorns? Among the 18 unicorns in Hong Kong, half of them came from university researchers. They were found by university researchers. So this is a very unique ecosystem that you don't see everywhere in the world. And also, from research to innofacturing, like Otto mentioned, when we do R&D in Hong Kong, so what's next? So you have sale to one, so what's next? We need translation. We need some proof of concept, places to do proof of concept, and then do trial, prototypings, all that. So at Hong Kong Science Park, we have the mandate to help this out. That's why last year, Hong Kong Science Park had revamped it, the three industrial estate. And of course, some of them the multi-story buildings are there already at TKO, and there will be more to come. Otto mentioned about microelectronics, and microelectronics center will be out in 2024. Will become a much bigger scale than what we used to have in Science Park. And third is F. So I was talking R, I, and F. F is finance. So finance we learned from 2019 when Chapter 18A was released for biotech pre-round funding IPO. That attracted a lot of biotech company came to Hong Kong listed without making profit yet. But we want to see this company came to Hong Kong while doing the fundraising, but also look into collaborating with our university, our local industry in terms of research, and also be able to learn this a place for us to do trial or prototypings in Hong Kong. So this could be all facilitated. So the Chapter 18C is under consultation. So this is another chapter besides biotech. And Otto mentioned about encouraging universities to do more translation. So I suppose the Chief Executive John Lee's policy address in October mentioned about the RISE 1+ scheme. So it's a research industry and R&D. And academia 1+ scheme having 10 billion Hong Kong dollars to be invested into 50 to 100 companies. So this is something that we should be looking into. Last but not least, to tap into GBA, I always say talent and technology has no boundary. So people can move around in GBA, Hong Kong, even internationally. And for technology-wise, and if I'm lack of some technology or routines in my development, I can acquire them, or sometimes I have to license them, okay? So people, talents, and technology has no boundary. What does have a boundary is policy and culture and the INT scene. So we are part of GBA, so Hong Kong is set clearly as we have to develop as an international R&D hub. So the keyword is in international. So we does have a different edge than the nine cities. So we shall be looking into further collaborations and the merit to engage the merits from all different cities and work make the whole thing work out. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Chai, for your insights on the success ingredients of translational research. So next, may I invite Dr. Stephen Wong, the Senior Vice President and Executive Director of Public Policy Institute, Our Hong Kong Foundation. Dr. Wong, please.
Thank you. I want to share my bold statement first, is that I would argue that Hong Kong cannot be successful in tech industry without GBA. And in fact, that sort of echoed the GBA policy paper. If you look at the GBA, Da Wan Chu Gang Yao, it actually, tech is the prominent feature in that. And interestingly, if you look at the Er Shi Da, the late speech by President Xi, he also, when he talks about Hong Kong and GBA, they are together. So in other words, I think that I would argue that Hong Kong or GBA cannot be successful if Hong Kong is not successful in building our tech industry. And that's huge, right? Because, you know, tech industry and therefore represent a next phase for Hong Kong. A Hong Kong that has a more diversified economy that is transit from, you know, where we are to the future. So that is the importance. And the second importance is that I would also argue that the tech industry, you have to benchmark the success of tech industry by two benchmarks. One is what Otto talks about, is the GDP. So what is our goal, right? If you have a blueprint, we need to know where the destination. And I think that if you compare to other areas, you know, 10, 20% within 10, 20 years is probably a reasonable target, which is not a low target. It's a pretty high target, actually. 10% means 300 billion Hong Kong dollars every year, GDP from tech industry, right? So that is huge. But because the second benchmark is that aside from GDP, is a private R&D as a percentage of GDP. If you look at, for example, as you all know, right, the R&D total spending is about 0.99% of GDP, let's say 1%. Half of that is private and half of that is public. And the public sector is already paying 0.5% as a result of the GDP. How much more that you envision the public can do? So it's going to be from the private sector, that 0.49%, you know, increasing from 0.5% private R&D to, let's say, 2%. So that's four times, right? And the question is, why would someone come here and do private R&D if they cannot come here and make more money as a result of that, or coming here? So money, market, industry is definitely the whole key point about this success of tech industry. So we have done two policy research reports with a think tank in Beijing and a think tank in Shenzhen to really look into one particular industry, biotech, to see how that can take advantage of the loop, as well as general cooperation between Shenzhen and Hong Kong. And yes, you know, we have done a lot in the past. If you look around us in the past couple of years, or even past decade, right, since SIPA, right, we have, you know, already allowed some measures for business of Hong Kong to go into to do business. And recently, there is 8 beneficial measures, 16 beneficial measures. There are joint academic programs. There are joint research lab. There is joint research funding. And so you are seeing quite a lot of cooperation that exceed this concept of, okay, we have front shop and back manufacturing. To some people would argue that Hong Kong should be front research and, you know, back development. But I think nowadays, people are largely coming to a consensus that it's actually going to be a full collaborative integration of the supply chain within GBA, including Hong Kong, in order to actually help the success of the tech business. So now we have looked into the past, and let's look at the future. I think there are a couple of things that needs to be done in the future. For example, when we talk about market, you know, I remember there's a global pharmaceutical company that talked to me, and they said one of the CEO visited them 5 years ago in Europe to persuade them to come to Hong Kong. And the answer is no. The answer is yes, but they don't want to. And the reason is, well, they asked the CEO, right? They said, well, why should we come here? What is the attractiveness of Hong Kong? How can we make more money by coming to Hong Kong, in other words, right? So there are a couple arguments that we can argue, especially in the biotech area. One is that if we can actually demonstrate that, hey, you know, by coming to Hong Kong, you are able to actually get the regulatory approval of MNPA, the drug registration board in mainland, faster than if you were to go to Shanghai or Shenzhen or even Hainan. And how do we do that? Well, because we have, you know, good clinical trial process, we have a good, you know, clinical effort, and we can manage that process together with the data flow and data sample flow. We can do everything in the loop, and therefore we are able to enable you to actually do your drugs by, you know, having efficient clinical trial process together with the GBA, having real-world data, because some of the drugs not being used in mainland are permitted to you to be used in Hong Kong. And thirdly, we can have faster drug registration, therefore you should come. I think some of these are regulatory barrier, that if we are able to remove these regulatory barrier, those are very industry by industry, very specific. We have to look into industry by industry very closely and at least start in the loop, because it's a small area. But hey, if you can't succeed and have institutional innovation and new institutional arrangements between all the cities for the loop, I think I doubt whether it can expand to a larger area. And lastly, I heard that the blueprint is coming out for tech INT by the end of this year, which I look forward to. And I am sure, like every one of you, we have written, we have talked, we have contributed to this blueprint. I am confident this blueprint is actually quite comprehensive, and you have everything that all of us talked about will be in there. But the question is how fast it can be implemented. The question is whether we have the collaborative effort, because it's not just in Hong Kong, it's across the border, because Hong Kong tech business cannot succeed without the GBA. So it's about collaborative effort to implement the upcoming blueprint. Hopefully we can rally all of us together to really get it done. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Wong. For your elaboration on the mode of integration, yes, Hong Kong tech cannot succeed without integration into GBA. So just now, many of you mentioned about utilize Hong Kong's unique advantages. So can you elaborate more on, in terms of INT, what are these advantages? Or to what extent can such advantages help Hong Kong to integrate into the GBA? May I start with Professor Chen, please?
Yes, I have 3 points. Hong Kong's role as a super connector. Second point, Hong Kong world-class university and its basic research ability. The third point, academic freedom, freedom of inquiry.
Thank you, yes. Super connector, world-class university, academic freedom. Thank you. So Dr. Poon, do you have anything to add?
Thank you. I think the ecosystem of the researchers in Hong Kong is not conducive to business. I find that for example, the university, each university, they have their own technology transfer office. And sometimes they are quite, the procedure, I believe, can be a little bit relaxed. Because I believe that all the universities in Hong Kong are basically 90% funded by the government, funded by public money. The research results of the professors should be, this is going to be controversial, should be the property of the public. It should be more open to the business people. And I think that's I know that's a controversial subject, but I do believe it, if the university can relax their criteria, that will help the research results. One further point is that each university have their own transfer technology or technology transfer office. I think if you look at the Great Bay Area, can we have one IP exchange? Allow the IPs to be exposed, to be promoted to not only in Hong Kong, not only the Hong Kong businessmen, but to the Great Bay Area where there are many industries who could probably use our research results to develop their business further, or even open to the entire nation or even worldwide. So I think these are two areas which I would like to emphasize. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Poon. Yeah, thank you. Dr. Chai, please.
Yes, I mentioned before about RIF, so I'm not going to repeat the standing of the universities. So, but you see, I mean, going into for university, extending their arms in the GBA, like PolyU is doing that in with Dongguan, Shongshanwu, and UST is doing that in Nansha, and then so does CHK and the others. I think it's essential that we all have to understand we have to nurture more talents for Hong Kong. Okay, from the last policy address for the development of Northern Metropolis and the recognition outside Science Park, we are talking about more than 250 hectares of additional INT land, which is four times of what we have today. So simple math, we need more than four times of talents. Can our university come up with this talent all by ourselves? Definitely no. So we have to recruit talents. Of course, in John Lee's policy address said that we have to compete for talent, compete for good tech companies. That's one way to go. But on top, I think it's essential for our university to set a very good foundation and have a very focused mandate to recruit, first of all, nurture our students, graduates from our university in GBA. Second, to nurture them and incorporate into our INT ecosystem in Hong Kong and GBA.
Thank you for both Dr. Poon and Dr. Chai's advice on the university's role. Yeah. Thank you. Dr. Wong, please.
Aside from the universities and IPO market, I would say four more. One is brand. I think it's inevitable that the drug registration board in mainland, MMPA, or the China FDA, will have to internationalize itself, meaning that it will have to let other countries internationally to trust MMPA as well. And Hong Kong, with our brand, can play a role by hopefully connecting and setting up our own FDA that is aligned with the MMPA and help them in the internationalization process. So that's number one, our brand. Number two is, as I said, the within the biotech framework, I think is the our HA, right, hospital authority, the data, the clinical experiences they have, and this is trusted internationally. Number three is a lot of this drug discovery is by AI, right? So, and also those are virtual, and therefore we all are quite competitive in that as well. And lastly, I think it's money. Yes, we have large families. And frankly, a lot of these large families that I spoke to, all of them are looking into tech, right? Probably because it's harder to make money in real estate these days or going forward. But I think the second or third generation are genuinely interested to changing the world, to making an impact by having the tech investment. So I think wealth is something that potentially works in our favor as well.
Thank you, Dr. Wong. Okay, so the next question is more on the concept of integration. So the integration means freer flow and better coordination of innovation elements, such as talents, capital, and property. So between Hong Kong and other cities of GBA and beyond. So how do you evaluate the current state of the integration process? So where do you see the synergies from, or where do you see the barriers or hindrance from? So may I start with Dr. Chen, please?
Yes, I have 3 points. Point one, we should have a regular coordination meetings between the corresponding leaders of Hong Kong and Shenzhen, particularly to address the technical transfer issue. Dr. Poon has mentioned this, and intellectual property issues. Second point, coordination among the education, science and technology, and capital market. Point three, bearing in mind that Hong Kong is in capitalist system, while Shenzhen is in socialist system, how these two systems excel complementary.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Chen, for the modes of coordinations. Thank you. So any other speakers? Yeah, Dr. Poon, please.
Mr. Chairman, I have nothing more to add. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Professor Liu, according to the GBA plan released, I think the year before, during Chinese New Year, okay? I mentioned that a few times to PICO secretaries and some electrical members, but not you, Stephen. Okay, not yet to you. So I said, according to the four floors, 人樓, 物樓, 資金樓, 資訊樓, there will be hundreds of questions from these four areas, from different stakeholders, like for industrialists, from university researchers, from research institute, from venture capitalists. They all look at all these hundreds of questions with different priorities in their mind. Mm-hmm. So someone shall come out together all these questions and set the priority. Some of them are Beijing has to help to solve it. Some of them are G2G, some of them are locally technical issues or between INT platforms, between Science Park and or the Science Park in Shenzhen, such that. And these questions shall be prioritized and look at it in a holistic way. But I don't think there's a think tank has done that yet. Yeah, so maybe Stephen, you'll be interested in. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Chai. Yes, Dr.
Yeah, I think, frankly, the four flows, if you have to rank the difficulties, capital is very difficult, right, because it's capital control. Data is very difficult because of the rules and regulations on both sides. But I think, Sunny, as you said, I mean, actually, I was in at least three or four groups that has been talking about cross-border data flow in the past couple of years, right? And some write submissions to various authorities. And it seems like it's not lack of effort, but it's probably lack of, coordination in terms of, okay, recently I was in this group talking about finance data cross-border, which is important, right, for financial institutions. But obviously, it's not just finance data. It's about samples, about data that actually be able to facilitate the biotech industry as well. So that's the four flows. And I think there are other barriers I haven't mentioned. It's the negative market access list, right? Because foreign investment cannot access to certain core industries, such as genetic testing and therapies, which we have a strong edge in. But if you are a Hong Kong person, SAP company, you are not allowed to actually be in those industries in China, in mainland. So so those are negative list issue. So just to throw that through.
Thank you, Doctor. Now, my last question is on the Northern Metropolis development. So we know that Hong Kong SAR government published its report on the Northern Metropolis development strategy in October. To what extent do you think the development of Northern Metropolis area can help Hong Kong to strengthen its status as an international INT hub?
Professor Chen. 短缺问题，现在香港各个大学的底非常小啊，这个我们像要引进那个人才，更发现我们校园非常急迫啊，所以北部大都会跨国地区呢，可以帮助香港科研地区垄断的问题。第二点呢，通过北部都会区呢，将香港强大的基础研究资源与内地庞大的市场和完善的产业链 能够紧密结合。第三点呢，北部都会区地域宽阔，可规划科研人才的住房。住房问题是很重要，我们可以在那里呢，怎么来解决科研人才的住房问题，提高对科研人才的吸引力。第四点也是最重要的，我认为香港不但要从西方吸引人才， 也要从祖国性人才，让祖国大陆的人才在香港资本主义的环境下发挥作用。Thank
you. Thank you, Dr. Chen. Yes, Dr. Poon, please.
One of the policy, one of the policies of the IBIB, Innovation and Technology, the Industry Bureau, is create a smart city, which is an area the Hong Kong Polytechnic University is very good at. Now, I think talking about smart cities, we have smart cities 1.0, and now we have smart city 2.0. But even up to now, we are treating the smart city issue as a blind man touching the elephant. There's no coordinated effort in the government. We had, I could mention the two lost opportunities. Kai Tak Airport, that could be constructed, designed as a mini smart city. West Kowloon Cultural District, that's another area, another lost opportunities. Now, I hope the Northern Metropolises, the government can capture this the opportunity to make the 2.5 million population a truly smart city with linkage in the Hong Kong area and also in Shenzhen and beyond. And I do hope the government could set up a coordinated body to create this as a smart city. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Poon. Yeah, making the North Metropolis area a truly smart city through coordinated effort. Yeah, Dr. Chai, please. Yep,
and right on the Northern Metropolis and the land recognition of Science Park. So this is a land we'll be having in the next, hopefully, 7 to 10 years, okay? So I think in the policy address it said very clearly that one thing I hope that will materialize in a very solid way is the attraction of a good tech company and the attraction of good talents. This is essential for Hong Kong to be built as an international IT hub. And so that incorporates into what I said earlier about the Hong Kong IT ecosystem in terms of research, innovation, and finance. So this Hong Kong's IT ecosystem will be an incorporate integral part of the GBA IT ecosystem and our country's IT ecosystem.
Thank you, Dr. Chai. Yeah, attract the tech giants, the tech talents. Yeah. Dr. Wong, please.
On Northern Metropolis, I think it should be considered fail if it does not have a successful tech industry in it, because Northern Metropolis will therefore become a larger Tinsui Wai. Right? So it's, and so therefore, the success or failure of tech industry is just a crucial part of the Northern Metropolis. Right? However, what is the largest business right now in Fanling, which is part of the Northern Metropolis? Fanling, essentially. Before COVID, it was Zhao Shui Fo. It was basically carrying goods across the border, right? So there's no industry. And so how do you change a place with no strong, high-quality industry into something that is like a Silicon Valley? Right, so I think that is not just about land. Land is necessary, but in some fishing condition. It's about all the institutional barriers that we just discussed. How can we facilitate people coming in so that they do R&D, and as a result of that, make more money? That's the long and short of it. Otherwise, if you look across Lo Hu Chu, which is not that big, the GDP is already 300 billion Hong Kong dollars, last time I checked, 3,000 billion. Well, it's just a small area, right? But Fanling and Shuangshui, what is the GDP? Therefore, I mean, it's not about just the land, it's not about the proximity, it's about the institutional barriers that we need to break through in order to attract business that can make money here.
Thank you, Dr. Wong. Okay, next, may I open the floor to the audience? For the audience, do you have any questions for the panelists? Okay, so in that case, firstly, thanks all of the distinguished panelists for your thoughts. So we know that today's forum also celebrates the inauguration of PolyU's university-level PReCIT. May I take this opportunity to ask each of the panelists to provide one or two policy recommendations to the government?
Oh, 政府各个部门之间要加强合作, 理顺合作机制，共同促进创客发展。另外呢，要调动专家和市场的力量，多方合力，所有的 stakeholder 一起，政府提供资金和支持，定位目标，但是要在操作上要依靠专家，要依靠市场。我们从来没有遇到这样好的发展机遇。第一，三个空前未有。第一，国家对科技的综合和普及要求空前未有。第二，国家对科学家的爱护和期望空前未有。第三，科学家实现理想、发挥才能的机遇空前未有。我的英文名字大家就叫我西西，实际上是信息系。那么西西系是 connected、coordinated and cooperation。Thank you.
Connected, cooperation and coordination. Thank you. Yes, Dr. Poon, please.
Well, as we all know, Hong Kong is unique. We have own currency. We have our own common law. And we have probably the best business people in the world all residing in Hong Kong. And yet, in the past 40 years, we have been not only, we didn't go forward, actually we went backwards. If you look at, if the government policy could look at what the Singaporeans, the Taiwanese, the South Koreans are doing, and encourage the INT industry, and they're not only concerned about real estate, retail, or the property industries, and put more resources, put more focus, and put more leadership into Hong Kong on to develop an enterprising INT industry.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Poon. Dr. Chai, please.
To share one thing I hope not to see in the future. Go back 15 years ago, if you remember, our bureau used to be called Industry, Commerce and Technology Bureau. So one day when I woke up, I was told that industry and technology were taken away from the bureau. So we had a bureau called Commerce and Economic Development Bureau, CEDB, which is head by Al Jiang Yao today. And then later on, we add back ITB, and then we have ITIB. Don't worry, Otto, I had problem to remember those abbreviations as well. So we hope this won't go back like 15 years ago, and I guess it won't. Second, what I hope to see by the time I get retired, Hong Kong INT would have its own ecosystem. That government had invested so much in the past two terms of government. In John's term, I'm sure with our wonderful LegCo members, we'll be helping Hong Kong to have our INT ecosystem thrive. And someday, governments doesn't have to back all the ecosystem up with all the public money. So the ecosystem should be running among our tech companies, industry, and ventures by itself.
Thank you, Dr. Chai. Dr. Wong.
My final thought, execution, execution, execution. They should implement the blueprint as soon as possible, collaboratively, because the window of opportunity is closing up.
Thank you, Dr. Wong. Thank you for your recommendations. Our center will take into account your comments, and based on which we will research and publish research papers and reports. Please keep supporting us. So we believe that through the concerted effort from the government, universities, industries, and professional society, Hong Kong can and will make significant contribution to the national INT strategy. So let us give another big round of applause to our keynote speaker and distinguished panelists. Thank you.
Thank you, our panelists. Please remain on stage. Now may we invite our President Tang to the stage and present souvenirs to our panelists. May our panelists please come to the front of the stage with Professor Liu. We'll start with Professor Chen. and Dr. Poon for the second. Dr. Chai. And Dr. Wong. Thank you. May our president stand at the side and we have a group photo together. Thank you very much. Please be seated. Thank you. Other than GBA INT development, carbon neutral cities and One Belt and Road development are also PreCIT's research directions. Make sure you don't miss the upcoming PreCIT's events. For details, you can follow PreCIT's on our official website, Facebook, and LinkedIn. To round up our wonderful event, may we now invite Professor Eric Cho, Head of Department of Applied Social Science and Co-Director of PreCIT's, to deliver us a closing remarks. Professor Cho, please.
President, distinguished guests, honorable speakers, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for participating in this forum on the integration of innovation and technology into the Greater Bay Area and the national system. I believe that through the exchange of ideas and views in today's forum, we are able to gain valuable knowledge into various INT topics that significantly matter in our life and community. Please join me in giving our visionary and honorable speakers and panelists a round of applause. Also, it is indeed my great pleasure to have you all here to celebrate PolyU 85th anniversary. And just now, witness the launch ceremony of the Policy Research Center for Innovation and Technology. Thank you for being with us today. And the establishment of the PreCIT comes at an opportunity time. Indeed, during the 2022 policy address public consultation, PreCIT were well positioned to submit recommendations related to the three research directions of the center, contributed by our directors and core members to the government and the chief executive. Conforming to the government's direction in developing Hong Kong into an international INT center, our center under the PolyU's umbrella aims to provide valuable support to the city's strategic development and integration into the INT plan. Apart from producing high quality, impactful research, the sustainable development of our city depends on steady supply of talents for different sectors and industries. Our university has demonstrated an unwavering commitment to promoting whole person education and research excellence. In order to improve human being, economic efficiency, and sustainable development, the center will strive to work with the university and collaborate with organizations and corporations from various industries to organize activities for our city's young adults. To be successful in our endeavors, we need to work together. The contribution of every partner institution, corporation, government agency, and stakeholders in society matters in bringing us closer to a brighter future. bringing this event to a close, I would like to convey my great gratitude to you for your support. Our special thanks once again to the honorable speakers, panelists, distinguished guests, organizers, co-organizers, supporting organizations, media partner, and audience member with us today. Without your presence and support, this event would not have been successfully organized. We sincerely wish that you will continue to support and join future events held by our center. Thank you once again, and I wish you well and healthy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Chow. Please be seated. Honorable guests, ladies and gentlemen, our event will conclude here. Once again, thank you for your support and hope to see you soon.